Sir?
Good morning.
Nice to see you again. But we have a lot of new commissioners. I'm sure they'd appreciate an opening statement.
Sure. My name is Steve Henderson. I have ran a couple campaigns. I'm currently running a campaign for circuit court judge. And I have given a lot of speeches about myself and talked about myself at nauseam. And oftentimes when I address those people, I warn them that giving an attorney a microphone and a captive audience is kind of risky. If you do like to talk, especially at the trial attorney. I know my time is so limited today, and I try to put as much in my application as possible. I would prefer to jump right into any questioning if there was any. If not, then I'd have to continue with talking about myself.
Well played, sir. Ms. Allen.
I've been fortunate enough, and good morning.
Good morning.
I've been fortunate enough to have had the occasion to ask you a lot of different questions and hear a lot about you, but we do have a lot of new commissioners, and I would like for you to take a few minutes, if you can, to let everyone know a little bit more about you that we don't see in the pages here. So I think that would be much appreciated.
Sure. Probably what's not in the application, if you can't tell. I'm very passionate about the law. Always have been. I didn't go into law school thinking I wanted to be a judge. That wasn't my particular ambition. While in law school, I took a trial advocacy class and fell in love with trials, and I wanted to be a litigator. So I knew that getting trial experience is hard in large firms, so I elected to work for the public defender's office here in Brevard County, where I knew I would get a lot of trial experience, litigation experience. Because that was my desire and dream at that time, was to be a trial attorney and a litigator, which I still love doing. When I went into private practice in 2010 is when I started thinking about being a jurist. And rather than focusing entirely on criminal defense work, I started to branch out into other areas of law, such as delinquency, which you all know what that is, which was an easy transition, except juvenile law is quite different. The elements of crime are all the same, but they are procedures quite different. Eventually that transitioned to dependency cases, which is also a completely different area of law, chapter 39. My law partner is also my wife. I prefer to say law partner than wife, which sounds like. She does 100% family law, so we started doing a lot more family law. So I've had a lot of experience in family law. I also branched out into doing more civil type cases. So I try not to limit myself one area of law, and to expose myself to as many different areas of law that I felt comfortable handling. I would not take a serious personal injury case, like a medical malpractice case or something like that. I would refer that to someone with more experience in that area. On the personal side, I did put a brief bio in there, just to give you a flavor about myself. I do have 5 kids. I'm a family man. My family very important. I enjoy spending time with my family. They are probably the most important thing to me. And it's one of the reasons why I really like doing a lot of delinquency work, because I like working with children. In dependency court, even though you're dealing with the parents, ultimately you're dealing with the child at the end of the day. I have tried at least 50 plus cases to jury. I have done countless non-jury trials, predominantly in circuit court. I have appeared in front of every judge in Brevard County. I have appeared before judges in other counties, in Erie County, Orange County, Seminole County, Judicial County, federal court, administrative law judges. So I have quite a array of different areas that I have practiced. And being in front of all those different judges has given me kind of a unique perspective, because not every judge is the same. They do things differently. They conduct themselves differently. And watching how they treat litigants, how those judges treat attorneys, I've learned something from every single one of those judges.
Ms. Allen, do you have follow-up questions?
I do. Mr. Henderson, what is it about you that we should consider that would set you apart from our other applicants?
I don't know all the applicants on there, because I did see a lot of new names that I'm not familiar with. I think it's my broad range of experience in different areas of law. I think it's my temperament. I've been known to have a very calm temperament, respectful. I'm not just saying that from my own personal view. I hear that from judges and attorneys all the time. So under the umbrella of temperament, you have other, I think I have other qualities, such as respecting, you know, pro se litigants, things of that nature. I think what really sets me apart from the applicants that I know on the list is predominantly my wide range of experience in other areas of law, being exposed to those areas of law. A lot of the applicants have been focused their entire career on one specific area of law. And I think life experiences are critical. I had a very unusual upbringing, having lived overseas, growing up overseas, and then returning back to the United States. I think gave me a very unique perspective. And as Brevard County and Seminole County become more diverse, we are seeing people from other countries moving into our counties and recognizing they may have different cultural ideas or issues. Being cognizant of that fact, I think separates me from some of the applicants.
Still got it? I'm going to have to pass it along. Still got it?
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning.
You mentioned having the experience of watching other judges and seeing what they, you know, do and don't do and learning lessons from that. So my question for you is, which judge that currently sits on the 18th Circuit would you model yourself after?
Let me preface that with saying I like all of the judges on the 18th Circuit.
Fair.
They're all great.
You're a Henderson critic.
I am, so I have to be cautious. I can't limit it to just one judge. There are aspects of all the different judges that I have picked up on. And Brevard County, particularly, we have a great judiciary.
So, which aspects?
As far as aspects, I think having a good temperament, being calm, is critical. I've seen some of our judges get frustrated with litigants or the attorneys. Maybe they've had a long day that I don't like to see. So demeanor to me is those attributes are critical. Understanding the needs of attorneys, having to appear in multiple different courtrooms. Some of our judges don't see that necessarily. They believe, hey, I have you, I need you at 9, but then I have other judges saying I need you at 9 as well. So that judges that don't understand that can be a bit frustrating. Most have been accommodating. But as far as positive attributes, the temperament, I like judges that issue rulings quickly and don't wait a long period of time. I like judges that are efficient in giving us hearing time. Getting hearing time, particularly in civil cases, is pretty challenging. So I like to see judges that are able to move the docket and get us in and my client to court as soon as possible.
So Mr. Henderson, I do want to make sure that commissioners who are new each get to ask you questions.
Yep.
So I want to ask you to, look, I appreciate your answers.
I've never had one spot,
but I'm going to move it along a little.
Okay.
So, Mr. Robinson.
Good morning, Mr. Henderson.
Good morning.
Why do you want to be a judge?
I've always wanted to be a judge since about 2010. I believe in public service. I'm going to get back to public service. That's my main goal. I know there are candidates that run for judicial office for financial reasons. That's not me. I'm not running for financial reasons. There are those that run for, lack of a better word, power or something like that. That's not me. I think the 18th Judicial Circuit deserves good circuit court judges. The circuit court does deal with serious matters. But to answer it in one word, you know, public service, that's really
statutory interpretation with ambiguous issues, you know, in terms of the terms that are actually used in the statute. How would you go about resolving that ambiguity if there's minimal case law and no legislative history?
I would go with the plain meaning of the statute.
What if the terms would result in absurd results?
I would do that for the DCA. I don't believe that's my job to legislate, decide what the legislature intended to do. So I would have to rely on the interpretation of the statute.
Mr. Dowdy?
Yes. Good morning, Mr. Dowdy.
Good morning.
What do you think has been your greatest accomplishment in your legal career?
Setting aside specific cases that I've handled, running a campaign in 2016, I'm proud of that. That was a challenging experience. You go from being an attorney to literally trying to become almost what I describe as a political candidate, and that is a hard transition. So jumping in late in February 2016 for the primary in August. I'm proud of the work we did, proud of the work I did, getting to the primary, the three horses in that race, and making it to the general. I'm particularly proud of that.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As a judge, how would you deal with pro se litigants that might end up in the courtroom?
Good, great question. As a practitioner, I do deal with pro se litigants on the other side. Not criminal, but civil injunctions, family law, that kind of thing. As a judge, I don't believe, you know, well, unfortunately, judges can't give legal advice to pro se litigants. So what I have experienced or noticed is that most pro se litigants want to be heard. So giving them the opportunity to be heard and have their day in court should be the focus. But if you have an attorney on the other side who's making proper legal objections, that put in the position of having to rule and follow the evidence code, and that can be frustrating to a pro se litigant because they don't know the evidence code. They don't understand objections. But unfortunately, as a judge, you can't tell them, you know, what the law is or how to make that objection. I think you just have to treat them with respect, explain to them that you cannot give them legal advice. I have seen on occasion more report, particularly like an injunction case, where the court has said, you know, if you'd like to retain counsel, I can continue this. I don't necessarily recommend that, but I have seen that as an option. But treating them with respect, dignity, as they should be treated, but also being firm if they get out of hand, because I've seen that happen too. And calmly explain to them, you know, man, sir, this is not how you conduct yourself in the courtroom. If that can get them calmed down, then that would be my goal. But it is a challenge. But I think as long as you treat that litigant, pro se litigant, with respect and dignity, and explain to them why you can't do certain things as a judge, they generally understand that. If you're running into a pro se litigant that perhaps is mentally ill, it becomes very, very challenging. But I would conduct myself in the same manner, respectful, courteous to them, and try my best to rein them in, so to speak. But never raising my voice or getting hostile.
Mr. Henderson, so you've applied, or you ran before.
Yes, sir.
You've met many of us a couple times, and we're running again or intending to run again.
I'm currently running.
Through that process, and you had a question earlier about, you know, continue to, you want to do this, have you had any change in perspective as to why you're pursuing this position or cementing your goal of this position or what the position is about through all those experiences?
You have this compound question, bro.
They're boring. Yeah.
Not really. Since I ran in 2016, my position on why I wanted to be a judge. The reasons behind that I have not changed. Obviously, I want to be a jurist. I would be continuing to apply and running a campaign, and it's not just because I personally want to be a jurist. I mean, obviously, everyone that wants to be, you know, running for judge or either going through this process has a personal goal of being a judge. Everybody. But from my perspective, the reason I keep running is I really want to be involved in public service, and I continuously get support from our judiciary. Hey, Steve, you'd be a great judge. I think you should run again. That's one of the main reasons I ran again this time and announced much earlier, August of last year. Qualifying is not to the end of April. But as far as why, that has not changed.
Next speaker.
So you're the only applicant who has taken a step of actually declaring and running a campaign.
Yes.
Why is that important?
As opposed to the JNC process?
Well, why is it, well, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but do you consider your decision to have filed and made that step and run a campaign a distinguishing factor from the other applicants, and if so, why?
Yes, I've noticed, at least in Seminole County, is we're seeing more and more people jump in against incumbent judges. And we haven't seen that really in Brevard County yet. So a sitting judge that has run a campaign, has the experience running a campaign, you know, knows what to do, knows what kind of campaign manager they need to get. I don't give all away all my secrets, but I learned a lot in 2016 that I've been able to apply this time. So I think that gives me a distinct advantage because I think this seat is up in 2024. So the applicant that gets this position needs to be prepared to run a campaign. I would say in 2023 to be prepared for the 2024 primary. Just in case.
Ms. Fallon has any follow-up questions? I know you were cut off.
No, my question is answered. Thank you.
Mr. Pickett, anything else? All right.
Thank you. Thank you.
We got back on within the 30 seconds of our time, so thank you.
Thank you all very much. Happy to.